Bumps and bruises, scratches and scrapes, all the ingredients that a good life makes. But sorrows become success, and as we aim for the top, we will pause if we must, but we will never stop. Welcome to Sim Soul Sessions. Everybody, and welcome to Sim Soul Sessions. This is our season finale, and this is a safe space to share your stories. We're sharing stories tonight, sisterhood and I. Tonight I'm sitting with my tribe, the ladies I started out with on this journey, who you guys ask me about all the time. Paula-Anne Porter Jones and Yvonne Chin Irving are my special guests tonight. My rapping crew in the place, and can I tell you, I am super excited. And also very nervous to, like, butterflies into my belly to sit with them and talk with them today. We're talking growing up. We're talking through our journeys. We're talking life in the spotlight. We're talking about milestones and where we are now in our lives and advice that we would give to our younger selves. So it's a sit down, and I'm going to sit down, from which we want you to get some key takeaways. And we're going to start with our lesson right now with the incomparable Paula-Anne Simone Porter Jones. We had to get that in there because a lot of people don't know.
They don't know.
AKA Pap. So if you hear me say Pap, you know, hi, girlie.
Hello, mama.
How are you doing?
I are nervous.
Yes. True by why?
Because, you know, I'm supposed to ask the questions.
Well, you can. So there's one thing, we set the ground rules. So this is a conversation. It's not an interview. It's a conversation.
Okay.
So we're catching everybody up, right? Because we speak. And you see me pointing outside because Chin is over there and a watchful eye. I don't like this. This feels so weird.
Yes, it does.
But we had a moment earlier in the guest room. But as we spoke, Pap, the gems just kept dropping out of you. And I don't even know if you realize that the gems were dropping. Well, just look on your face tells me you don't realize the gems.
Okay, so you are asked
yes,
first, and
I
then
will,
let's see
I will.
What that is.
But first, let's talk about that moment we had in. So I walked into the makeup room. And yourself and Chin were in there, and then we all started to tear up. So what was that in words?
I think that those of us that were at RAPPIN at that time with Mr. Wycliffe Bennett, there is something. It was at such a pivotal moment in our lives when we were becoming young women. We were growing up in front of people on TV as we learned about ourselves, about each other, about this world that we chose to stay in. And that's not something that we are reminded of often together in the same space. It was just a lot.
I know. It's hard to vocalize and verbalize. And even as we sit, there's a cameraman who's here. So Emil is here. And Emil started with us on the journey as well. Mm-hmm. From first shoot, come right up. So it's really an amazing, when you think and sit about it, does it feel like it's been?
Don't you dare say how long.
A while? Does it feel like?
It doesn't, especially, well, first, Emil looks the same way.
Yes.
And Emil is the same way. From when we were just starting with TV and learning, he was always. I don't remember anything else but
it's
him
true.
Being supportive
it's
and
true.
A little
it's
whisper true. In the ear to say, don't worry, all right, or chin up, or whatever it is. So it doesn't feel like however many years you were tempted to say a while.
Yeah,
ago.
Well, you said it when we spoke about decades, and I was like, don't do that. Do you feel any differently? Put your hair back. See, one thing is different about you is your hair. Do you feel any differently?
I think I'm now beginning to feel differently because I'm approaching landmark
So you did it. You
landmark.
Went there.
Mark. No. But I have to say, because up until last year, I didn't know without checking, like, how old I am or what's happening. It was just about, hey, we're doing what we're doing. And even when I did or do present for television, it just is the same thing. It's like a step into a space where we just always were. You don't lose it. You go in, you do what you're doing, and then you step back out and back into real life. So I didn't feel any differently.
Here's a funny thing. I had to coax you and Yvonne to come and sit in this chair.
Yeah, because we're supposed to be in that chair asking the question.
Well, I just told you that you could. Yeah. But the irony of the situation is that we all present, but we just rather lock up somewhere. And, you know, the paradox of it, Pap, what has this journey done to just your crave or your desire to just be anonymous? You know, because you've grown up, you've gotten married, you've had a family. Mm-hmm. But you were like, I want to keep all of those to myself. So
it's funny because even though still being in the media makes my life, your life very public. You step outside, you're in your slippers, t-shirt, etc. It doesn't matter because people hear you in their space. They hear me on the radio and they think, well, they're allowing me inside of their space, in their personal space. So therefore, it is vice versa when we're in person. And so a lot of my life is public, whether on the radio or out, anywhere else. And so it makes it, we only have a little bit that we get to keep to ourselves. And I kind of guard that, especially when it comes to how I feel about certain things, how people don't know necessarily what's going on inside my head. They only hear what I choose to share. So it's not a difficult thing to say yes to Sim Soul Sessions, which is now known for going inside people's heads and hearts and bringing out things to share. And I'm like, no. All the other things I share, I don't say already.
Yet here you are.
And it's funny, I'm saying to Chino as we're sitting outside, Yvonne Chin, Chino, that, okay, when I'm advising my clients, I tell them, all right, when you're wearing an outfit, pick something that it's easy to make. You know, maybe something with a collar or buttons. Yeah, right. That's not a poor, you know. And then I'm saying to her, what something is? I said, I always tell my clients, when you're preparing, you know, you're supposed to do that, which was
nothing.
Nowhere in my head.
None of it. It's okay. It's numinous. It's numinous. We're going to talk some more with Mrs. Porter-Jones when we come back. And yes, we're going to go in our head a little bit. She don't know, but we are. We'll be right back with that after this. All right, back with Pap, talking a little bit about how life has unfolded for you. And interesting for me to find out that you've kind of seen yourself as not like everybody else. So goals and lofty ideals and all those things that many of us would set when we were younger. You know, I always looked at you, Pap, as the person who always had it together at CPT. So I was like, this girl has it all together. Why am I making so many mistakes? But to learn that you are just in this place where you live it as it comes, and that sometimes you feel like almost a failure because of that, you don't have these lofty dreams. And
so it's the one thing I can remember wanting or saying that I would like to have this is a family with enough children. I remember that.
Five, in fact.
Yes. It was five. Beyond that, I don't have a dream car. I don't have a dream house. I want to travel the world. I enjoy life as it comes. As opportunities arise, I look at them and I say, oh, that would be nice. Or let's try this. Or how does this work? But it's not that some people have planned their lives and they say this is X, Y, Z. I tried it once when I just left college. There was a P1, P2, P3, the different phases, but that soon fell by the wayside. and I got the family.
Yes.
And I'm enjoying the family.
Yes.
But beyond that, it's about taking each day as it comes. different days bring different things. There are some successes, but there are many failures. There are many times when I look back and I think, okay, maybe I should have done that differently. Oh, well.
Tomorrow is another day to get it right.
And move on.
Can we talk a little bit about that family? Because you have a fantastic family, which is, I guess, why you wanted to have one of your own. You did have the four kids. You wanted to adopt one.
Right.
And you started on that process. Yeah, but it never worked out.
No. So we agreed, John and I, my husband, that he also wanted a large family. We thought, well, five would be good. They would have each other. They would play together. And we also thought that we could provide. We had enough love to share for
enough
others as
share.
Well. No, well, it's true. Because you want kids in an environment where they don't feel left out, that everybody feels like they have their space, but they also belong.
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that we felt together strongly about. So that was a plan. And if we have five, they want to put the adopted child in the middle. I spoke about that all the time. I'm going to have five kids. And then we had two, and we started the adoption process. But unfortunately, the system wasn't very organized at the time. So we started. First, it was really difficult. And eventually, after about a year or two, they reach the phase where they're supposed to come to your house now and look at how you are in your space to make sure that you're not abusing your own children or whatever. You're not no ogre. And they never came. And it stalled. And we called and asked, and nothing happened. And then we just moved on. And then we had the other children, two more. And then it wouldn't work anymore because we didn't want to have the adopted child as maybe the last one, or the others all grow up together, and then, so we just let it die a natural death, if that's not too morbid a phrase to use.
Yeah.
But having lots of kids is lovely.
Yeah, and how you're raising them is interesting, because I said to you, you know, they're so successful, and you're like, Sim, I don't like the labels.
No, I guess like many other young people, we try to give them as much opportunities as possible. We try to provide for them the lessons that will help them to manage on their own.
Mm-hmm.
And then you kind of half step back and watch them and hope that they take the right decisions, and that the right decisions they take are the decisions for them, not because we tell them, but that because they believe that this is the way forward based on what we set for them.
Yeah.
So far, so good. I'm just proud that they're managing.
Yeah.
So far, so good.
Because you say mother, I asked you what kind of mother you are, and you said you don't ever call yourself a successful mother, because it's an everyday process, and
it
every
is.
Day you learn something new.
It is.
And try to shed something, or try to gain something.
And each child is different.
And
I want to ask you about you and your one, but for me, I am looking now
at my
second son, and thinking, how come I never thought that with the first one? You mean I missed that opportunity, or I don't think I handled it so well the first time around, or let me try this way? And it's funny because you have grown as a person. By the time you get to your child number three, Simone, you will be a different person than when you just started with Aaron. So, and it's trying to figure out where you, the new Simone, is, in terms of how you see the world and what you think is the best way with this person who is different and will be different from Aaron in terms of personality.
Don't hear what Paula-Anne is doing? Chin hear what Paula-Anne is doing? Is this like a prophecy?
What? Speak it into being?
Yeah.
What is to be will be, Simone. Don't fight it. Don't fight it.
Paula-Anne, we've got some good vibes for you. Run it, Laura.
Good vibes?
Yes.
Paula, just wanted to share how proud I am of you, how happy I am for you, how honored I am to be your friend. You are a true gem, a gift to the nation, not only as a media practitioner, but as a person, as a parent, as a role model for women and young girls. You are an amazing mother and cheerleader to your children. You are the biggest supporter of your friends and family. I am very lucky to be one of those.
Thank you, Paula, for being my mentor, my muse, and my friend for more years than I want to mention on this show. I am so grateful to you for all the opportunities that you have sent my way. I thank you for your guidance. I thank you for your support and your encouragement as I embarked on a media career with you as a light to let me know where it is that I should go. I wish you all the best, and I can't tell you how much I love you. Take care, Paula.
P, how could I miss this opportunity to say that you are my ride or die? Over 20 years, that's two decades of unshakable friendship. That is truth checking. That's beautiful that you are my one call and secret keeper, and I yours. I admire you as a broadcaster. I admire you as a mother. You are the consummate professional.
It's important that we have good friends in our life. Someone you can count on, and they can count on you as well. And knowing that friend has your back and will be there for you, like Paula, that's a friend to cherish. But sometimes it takes a special type of person to build that something special with. Something that makes it more than an ordinary friendship. That is why we share a special decades-long relationship, and why we'll be friends for life. Love you.
I do want to remind you that it's greatly appreciated that you're always there, or at least you try to be there when you can, for your children, for your family, for everyone that you hold dear and holds you dear as well. I want to thank you, because I don't think I'd say it enough, and I hope you have a wonderful day.
You are the only woman that I know, the only person, the only human that I know that can fit 48 hours into 24. And I know Daddy tells you that all the time, and I don't know how many other people tell you that, but it amazes me every day how much you are able to do in the same day that we all get. I'm trying to get all these things done, and it's impossible. No one can do what you do, and you are amazing. You are the best mother anyone could ask for, the best friend anyone could ask for, and I love you, and I'm proud of you. You're an inspiration to myself and to many. And there are so many things about you that I strive to be in life and maybe will never be, but you are a great role model and a great person to have brought me into this life and to have helped guided me through and I to have helped guide me through. And I'm just so grateful for you and so proud of you every day and happy that I get to share you with the world.
Sometimes you're on the road biking. Sometimes you're in the hills hiking. Sometimes in the bushes, bird observing, but always ensuring Mother Nature you are preserving. We sometimes worry when you're gone diving, but deep down we know you'll be surviving. You're always an example to your brother and to your children, the perfect mother. So whether you're home or you're gone afar, may God keep you the sweet, loving daughter you always are.
Paula-Anne, when you were born, your dad and I knew that God had given us someone special in our lives. And over the years, you did not disappoint. We are proud of you, of your myriad accomplishments, and admire your courage and sense of adventure and how you approach life like nothing bothers you. I must admit that your sense of adventure makes me very nervous at times. But we realized from you were little that you have the spirit of a bird that needs to fly free. You're always giving me advice, encouragement, and motivation. And at times when I tend to worry and stress over situations, you have a quiet, calm, gentle, and patient way of making problems seem minuscule as we work together to find solutions. You're such a loving person. Your voice and your smile brightens my day. When I grow up, I think I would like to be like you.
It's not fair. You said no crying things. You said that's not fair.
What? I didn't make any pro. I may have, but you know, these things happen.
I never knew my father was a poet.
I didn't know either. Daddy Roy, Mommy Icy, how are you? Love those folks. I mean, chin from we had our knee. Anyway, all your flowers, because you deserve them all. I love you. I am proud of you and who you have become. And I think what you are doing just for Jamaicans every day is amazing. And we're going to catch up again when Chin comes on the set. But next, we're talking to Chin by herself. She's not going to cry. She doesn't cry a lot. She's going to go so cold. I love every minute of that show. We can't get 1 hour more. Welcome back, everybody. Back with the Rapping crew. And when I think back on my days with this lady, I remember we had a lot of laughs. And boy, did we shed a lot of tears. And turns out we had some of the same issues, right? So it's no wonder that she's been such a source of inspiration for me on my journey. Yvonne messages me almost every single show to say, Sim, that was awesome. And I just want to tell you tonight that you are awesome and that I think your gift for this industry is above and beyond. And it's something that I don't think even you know. Come in and know nobody in my life, Yvonne, who beat up on themselves like you. So, hi.
Hi.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
When I was trying to get Pap to think about memories, she couldn't remember much. But you could remember that Yvonne did cry a whole heap.
Yeah.
That journey starting out was rough.
Yeah, it was. Learning can be difficult. And for me, that time of behind the scenes, trying to learn the rudiments of broadcasting, it was tough. And one of my memories is being in a voice and speech class and not doing very well, mm-hmm. and feeling very embarrassed and saying, oh God, I'm going to cry and everybody's going to see. And the lights went and I cried.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
God gave you a little darkness so you could cry.
Yeah. As you grow, you're going to get some bumps and bruises. So I had some
scratches and scrapes.
Some scratches and scrapes indeed. I had some of that, but give God thanks.
Yeah. You said to me, we were kind of like the social media of our time, right? Yeah. It wasn't really around then.
Yeah.
And so we kind of had to grow up in front of everybody. I mean, you tell me you were popular in high school, so popularity wasn't a new thing to you.
Yeah.
But that came with its own set of challenges because people always had things to say and comparisons were always made.
Yeah.
And that was the difficult part, is that there were times when I felt, as did you, that we just weren't cutting it.
Yeah.
We weren't cutting it. Was there any point where you questioned whether you really needed to be here or if you was going to walk away?
Sure.
You may have walked away.
There are several points. Ron will testify to, Amiel will testify to being on set one day when I thought, you know, I'm not getting anywhere with this. I'm just not good at this. Mid-set, mm-hmm. in a recording, and I walked off the set and they took a break and we had conversations and I came back. But I really felt like I just don't have what it takes. I remember one time having a conversation with Mr. Bennett. I told Mr. Bennett, I said, sir, I don't know what else to do. He said, darling, you're trying too hard. Yeah, it was tough. It was tough. And yes, there were many times that I decided I wasn't coming back. There was one time, I remember we used to have these performances at the Ward Theatre. And after some bad rehearsals, I just disappeared and just came up
as a guest to the show. Hi, everybody, you're looking great. Yeah.
Come on. But Chin, even as we sit here so many decades later, as good as you are at this job, do you even love, do you love TV?
I love people.
You love people.
I love people, and that love comes out in different ways at different stages. There was a time when I loved little people, children, and so, you know, it was my thing that we must have children shows and we must allow the children to have a voice. And there was a time when I loved news presentation, and there was a time when just that production process of coming up with that idea and working those long hours and seeing that thing come to life so that people could feel and it could think and it could respond. That was my love. And now I'm at a stage where my coaching business is what is really very close to my heart and my relationship with God and just encouraging his people along the way. So it is that I love people. And sometimes television is what is in front of me and what is in my hand, and I will use that to reach people. But right now, it's not my preferred space.
That's so incredibly amazing.
I like my quiet behind the scenes.
So all of this training and stuff, and Paula running one direction, you running one direction, if me not the other road, I mean, it's almost like it's changed all of us.
Yes, yes. I appreciate reflection. I appreciate getting to know who I am on the inside. I check myself. I check myself with social media, for instance. I check myself. Are you trying to get the applause of the crowd? Who are you becoming? Like, I will show up and then I will pull back. Even check myself.
Even to market the business. You're like, I don't want to... You know?
Yeah.
So it's that balance, that straddling. Gosh, we're going to talk some more with Yvonne, because Yvonne has also, you know, I was going to say she's become a wife, but somebody's become her husband, after all. I want to talk about what that journey has looked like for her and her relationship with God, which she mentioned. And we'll be right back to talk through that in a bit. This girl worked her way up from PA to news anchor. I remember when you sat in a news chair and you were working as a news anchor. You're so good at it, Yvonne. And you used to leave and go on the road. Sometimes you used to walk or take bus. That was a point of discussion for so many people as to how you could be doing that. But here you are now sitting, having done that and conquered that. You went abroad to work, and then you came home, and you left grounded in faith. But you say in your 20s, things weren't happening the way you wanted them to happen.
No.
And so you said to God,
Later,
I'm going to do this my own way.
Yeah.
And boy, did you buck up into some things.
I know, though, right?
Eh?
Yeah, it's typically what you call your turn back.
Yes.
Yeah, my turn back in my 20s. And I think a lot of young people go through it in their 20s, where they feel like everybody else is progressing, where they feel like people are falling in love, people are getting married, they're having families, their career looks good. It just looks good. And you feel very unspecial.
What about me?
Very ordinary. You feel like you're not getting anywhere. And so I said, okay, you know, I'm doing this my way. And it didn't work out. It didn't work out, Simone, because so many times we make bad decisions. We make bad relationship decisions. We make bad decisions about our values. We make bad decisions about our careers. We make bad decisions. And guess what? It leaves baggage. And then you find yourself carrying this baggage around. And so I'm so glad that God is a forgiving God. And that he's a God who embraces us wherever we are. You're not for fix up yourself. Like, don't fix up, you know. Just enter that kind of relationship with him that moves from religion, where you're doing what you think you're supposed to do, to actually investigating it, to actually really testing and seeing and trying and say, okay, God. And I've had those moments where I said to God, Lord, you know, I'm so broken. Lord, fix me because I don't want to.
You broke me.
Yeah.
You fix me.
Yeah, God, fix me, Lord.
Because you told me, you said to him at one point, because if this is how I want to live,
I'd rather die.
Oh, if it's how I'm going to live, I'd rather die.
Yeah. Yeah. And Simone, it might sound extraordinary, but it's not. I'm talking to young people all the time who are feeling a sense of disappointment, who are feeling like the relationships in their lives aren't working out, their lives aren't working out, who feel like they're not going anywhere. And now they have social media where everybody's best image is posted and they feel like, I'm not worth it, I'm not special. And so they themselves are at that place. And I would want to say, you know, I do want to encourage anybody who's listening who is at that point to say, hang in there. Mm-hmm. To say, no, you are a prototype. You are one of a kind. There is none like you. Take it easy. Be patient. It's okay. It's going to work out. And that extraordinary things look very ordinary.
Yes, like, ma'am.
Yeah,
that is a big talk,
yes,
you know?
Yes, very ordinary.
Yes.
They look like just getting up today and facing the day. They look like the time you're spending tonight writing in your journal, asking yourself, who am I? And asking yourself, why did I make that decision? What was driving that? What was I looking for? Do I know who I am?
Mm-hmm.
Who am I comparing myself
mm-hmm.
with? You know, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's those times mm-hmm. that look so ordinary. It's learning how to find hope and positivity and to be grateful. It's a training of yourself. Very ordinary things, Simone. Very ordinary things. And in the end, because you do it again and again and again and again,
it becomes
yeah. who you are.
You sound like Jeffrey Campbell, Agent Sasko, who sat in that chair and he said, your life is a series of decisions.
Yes.
You are the author, right?
Yes.
Along with the big man.
Yes.
But that sometimes we search for fulfillment in these big lofty things.
Yes.
And it really is in what I call it, the simple things. And he said, no, there's nothing simpler about
no.
them.
No.
And that's exactly what you're saying. The extraordinary things usually look,
yes.
you know. So you moved on to the marriage milestone. You always wanted love and family and we spoke about that a little bit, and you say marriage, you want people to know, is work.
Marriage is work.
Is work, and you need to look at the marriage as another person, you say.
Yes,
said.
Yes.
What do you mean by that?
I mean that sometimes it's easy to say, what's good for me? And for you to say, what's good for you? But for us not to say, what's good for our marriage as well. Because sometimes what's good for you is not good for the marriage. But when you recognize that the marriage itself needs attention, that the marriage itself is in development, that it needs nurturing, then that's when you are able to really go through the tough times and get past your feelings.
She need a show. She need a show. But before she get her show, make us send her some good vibes now. Some good vibes for you, Maggie.
Hi, YCI. I just want to remind you that for myself, and all the others you've come in contact with, you are more than a mentor. You're more than a lecturer. You're a friend, a sister, a confidant. You're a pillar of strength. And out of the 8 billion people that exist today, I am happy to have met you, happy to have forged memories and experiences with you. You've taught me so much, and I want you to keep applying your special sauce. I want you to maintain your transformational spirit as you get set for success. I love you always and forever.
Sister friend, it's a joy to turn the tables on you this time around and just to bless you and just to say thank you for being the beautiful, compassionate, authentic, vulnerable, godly example that you have been. And I speak on behalf of the young ladies of Esther, the ministry out of Family Word and Worship Church. Yvonne, thank you for just being such a godly example. You are an absolute gift and we love you. And on a personal note, oh, Yvonne, I love you with my whole heart. And I'm so grateful to call you friend and to do life with you in this season. And you know how we do it. We love you bigly, girl. We love you bigly. And we really believe that your best is ahead of you.
We love you. We are so proud of what God is doing in you and through you. We bless the work of your hands and we bless what you are about to do. We are privileged and honored to be called, you know, your pastors, Pastor Trudy and I, and your friends, your big brother. I bless you. I thank you. We love you. Keep doing what you're doing. God bless you. Everything you put your hands to will be blessed because you are an awesome woman of God. You are no doubt called by God for such a time as this to do a mighty work and to bring him glory.
I've known you most of your life, and I've always found you to be an extremely decent person, honest, deeply philosophical, spiritual, and very brave. Many people use your humble beginnings as an excuse for failing to do something, failing to achieve, but you have used your humble beginnings as a launch pad, and you have certainly launched off. I certainly miss the days when you used to cool out on long drives and talk about everything, and the days of coming to Kintyre and sitting with your family and just cooling out for hours on end. You are a fantastic person, you are brave, you are progressive, and I certainly again congratulate you not only on overcoming the social thing that most people can't overcome, but also on being a fantastic human being. I'm very honored to be able to say this to you, Yvonne.
I love you so much, and I am so glad that you are my auntie and I can talk to you about my emotions and stuff.
You're the best godmother, auntie, a sister, friend anyone could ask for. I love you. We love you.
Mwah! I just want to say that, Yvonne, you are amazing. You are inspirational. My life would have never been the same without you. Thanks for holding my hand all the time and for encouraging me and for pushing me to be the best I can be. Love you.
I just want to tell you how much I love you and how I am proud of you. Proud of the woman you've become. You know, you were always the kind of woman that want strive for excellence. You just love to share and to give, and that is who you are. Just keep on doing what you're doing. God bless you. I love you, my dear.
This was not the plan. Paula, I think she tricked us.
Flourish and bring. I'm just.
But thank you. Affirmation is important. Thank you.
Every day, all day.
Thank you.
You know I love you, girl. Coming back, we're going to wrap it up with a kumbaya moment after this. Sunko. Final segment, everybody. Wrapping up with Pap in one chair, Chin in another chair. Chin, you were saying that there are some folks who are integral.
Yes.
In where we all are now. Mm-hmm. I don't think we're afraid to start listing because,
worries.
You know, we may leave out people. Mm-hmm. But people like Auntie Faye.
Yes. I really want to give a shout out to Auntie Faye for not just the times when we were being taught in her classes, but for the time she did auntieing with us, you know, pull you aside and spoke into your ear.
And which has not stopped.
No.
Which has not stopped.
To this day.
And she'll probably give us a call out of this. Did you pronounce a word?
I'm hoping.
So many people, and people who were a part of the team with us. Lisa
yes.
was there.
Yes.
Libby mm-hmm. was there. Mm-hmm. Naomi Francis, who is now at OPM.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, folks have come out of this foundation mm-hmm. and have been able to build incredible foundations.
Yes.
And Emil was saying to me earlier that, you know, when he sees and hears about the three of us sitting on one set, it makes him emotional because nobody knew back then what Wycliffe was building, right?
Yeah. Ordinary looking, right?
We didn't know.
No.
Yeah.
We didn't know that we'd still be here
yes.
sometime later, a couple of years later.
Emil is a part of not, I mean, Mr. Bennett was building it, but the family that was there at CPTC is really what helped us because we were growing up.
Of course.
We were little girls growing
up. Of course.
And the kind of support, Denzi, Claudette, all of them.
Oh, Kathy.
Kathy, Lorna, Bev in the library. Roland.
Yes. I mean, Debbie's here. A lot of the CPTC folks are now here at TVJ, so it's like the family is just never unbroken. Yeah.
It was an environment that I thought was just one that is, you can't duplicate it.
Can't replicate. And so for the young broadcasters who are now watching, who are stepping in a time when social media is a thing, who from the first thing you utter on screen, they're asking, when I started radio, somebody called Rasman and asked, why you have that girl on the air? First night, right? And now you have people who will tweet and say, she not sound good, him not sound good. What do you say to that young person who's stepping into the industry now?
I think you should have your circle.
Yes.
Be very careful about your circle. And have in that circle people who will tell you the truth, but who will tell you the truth from a good place.
With love.
With love. Mm-hmm. And who have your best interest at heart. Have your circle.
Have your circle.
I'm so glad to have had my circle.
I think how you started your show is an excellent way to describe how I have looked at it and how I think will work for them too. If you think of it as an experience that is going to have the bumps, it is going to have the bruises, you're going to drop on your face, on your bottom, you're going to bawl. But if you open yourself to accepting it as a part of the growth and the experience, sure, and you embrace the fear, because there's a lot of
key.
That.
It will make it stronger.
So let them say what them want to say. You know what you want. Go after it and be diligent about doing it right.
Advice to your younger self. Look back at Pap when she started.
Save more.
True, important. Save more. Can I get an amen? Amen.
Save more. It's hard. It's hard because I think the mistakes I made, I really do believe that they were integral to who I am and how I see life now. So there's not a lot that I would say, don't do this or don't do that. I would say listen more, because we've had the opportunity to be in close association with so many people who've taught us and who've had things to say, family, friends, and otherwise. I think perhaps just listen more would be one.
What about you, Chinner?
I'd say be patient. Be patient with yourself. Be patient with God. And I'd also say you're special. You don't allow the comparisons around you to define you. You're special. Maybe you haven't discovered all the bits yet, but you're still a gem. You just haven't discovered it.
Right. On that note, head on over there. But first, we take a selfie. Come, Pap. Yes. Selfie time.
Head over.
Just catch onto the...
Over air.
Onto the side. I'm very bad at this, by the way, so let's try. Ready? Oh, let me flip this. Uno.
Oh, you flipped it. Nice.
Cheese. Do your thing, Miss Producer. All right.
I'm delighted to participate in this conversation about Yvonne Chin Irving, Paula-Anne Porter-Jones, and Simone Clark, who were part of a team of youngsters who my husband Wycliffe Bennett trained in voice and speech so he could use them as a high school debating team, and whom he influenced to do advanced training and enter the broadcasting system in Jamaica. I have followed their careers with pride as they specialized and moved up the ranks as broadcasters, producers, directors, trainers. They handle standard English as well as the Jamaican dialect with authority and clear distinction between the two, as it should be. They and others from the team continue to be role models for the Jamaican youth in their fields of specialization.
I have only fond memories of CPTC. The stories we told, the impact we made, the talent that was unearthed and nurtured, phenomenal. and three roses bloomed. Simone, Yvonne, and Paula. What a thing. These women have made and continue to make an indelible mark on the media landscape. All are exceptionally talented women who use their time and skill to educate and entertain. I'm also honored to call all three my friend. I've had the pleasure of having a special relationship with all three and can't wait to see what they do next.
Yvonne, Paula, and Simone. I've known you guys from you were in high school, and I saw your growth. I saw your appointment as disciples of the late Wycliffe Bennett, and I saw the entire program. I grew up with you too. And I'm so proud of you because you have embodied everything that Mr. Bennett wanted in his disciples. Love of the job, love of people, respect for authority, respect for people, encouraging others, motivating others, providing a safe space for people to function in. In our industry, it can be a real tough place. But one thing we learned at the CPTC under Wycliffe Bennett was how to make people comfortable and how to bring out the best in others. And you have gone on in your respective careers and you have done that. And you know what? You have excelled. You're at the peak of your craft and you have done so well. And I'm proud of you as my colleagues and my sister friends.
Why, CPTC and RAPPIN seems like a lifetime ago, but only yesterday, not to mention all the other productions we've been involved with in the years following. I'm so proud, so impressed, and so pleased with you ladies. Can't imagine this industry without you all, and I'm glad that I don't have to. If, especially as a dear, close friend, I'd like to thank you. You'll never know how much I've learned what a friend is from you. It's my honor to call you my friend. Paula PJ, watching you expand and glow as a woman, as a mother, as a professional, as a wife, makes me Wycliffe Bennett proud. The force of all forces has definitely been with Uno, and may he continue to guide and bless and keep. Love you guys.
Sim Sim of P and Chinny Chin Chin.
Our beloved rapping presenters and Mr. Wycliffe Bennett's disciples. Our CPTC family, you have all grown up so much as individuals and media specialists, and we are so proud of you.
Simone, you have such a way of peeling back the layers to get to the heart of the matter.
Right. And PP, your photographic memory, your poise, confidence, and impeccable delivery have always been impressive.
Chin, you're so blessed with the ability to empathize and connect with people in such a genuine way. You communicate so beautifully.
Mm-hmm. And as Mr. Wycliffe Bennett said, darling, you must occupy space and don't apologize for your presence. I just know he would be beaming with pride to see the greatness in you in such glorious light.
We love you guys. We're happy for you, and you will always, always be dear to our hearts.
Yep. What a thing.
Was Mr. Bennett's signature phrase, what a thing. Do not apologize for your presence. Always occupy
space.
Something I say to my students all the time. You say to your students all the time.
I'm hearing in my head every time I want to lean on somewhere.
No, darling. No, lean on that chair. Darling. I'm heading back over to my seat. Come over, Pop.
Darling.
We're going to stay. Oh, Pop is going to stay. All right, so I'm going to come over here.
Coach.
Thank you, Lauren.
You have space.
Guys.
Coach.
I don't even have the words to describe this session. What a blessing.
Yes.
And what a joy. Mm-hmm. I would rather not be on this journey with anyone else. We have work to do.
Yeah.
And we're going to keep doing it.
Yes.
It's not a commercial program, folks, but let me tell you. Trainers and coaches over here. These two, best in the business.
Trainers and coaches.
We believe in what we were taught and we are happy to impart. And
yes.
So we are here to help if and when to continue the work that Wycliffe has done. I love you guys.
Love you,
love you, love you, love you, love you. Yeah. Affirmation time. Yeah. I want to go over there with them in the chip. It's now time for our affirmation. Oh boy, so you can have all the knowledge in the world, but if you know not yourself, you know nothing. You can have all the love in the world, but if you love not yourself, you can love nothing nor anyone else. And you can have all the fame and adulation in the world, but if you have not value in self, you have nothing. And you can achieve what you thought you wanted in life and realize one day that it is not enough and you want more, or that it's too much and that you actually want less. It's okay to change your mind. You can't live anybody else's dream. You can't star in anybody else's show. I mean, we should all be aspiring to great, lofty goals and to living our best life, right? But what that looks like to you may not be the same for me. The marker is your gut. It never steers you wrong. So you use that as your GPS in the search for joy and fulfillment, because being the best version of you while you are here and living purposely with people you love, making moments that move you, that is the highest goal any of us could ever hope to achieve. So tonight we are affirming, I will strive to realize that sometimes there is so much more in less. And that is our soul food and our show for this evening. Thank you for watching, everybody. And to Grace, the VM Group, and Flo for helping us share these stories this season. It's our season finale and a great way to end. We're here next season. Pray for us, right? Season 6 on the horizon. Give us a couple of months. And then by God's grace, we'll be right back here sharing other stories of the power of the human spirit. Until then, every blessing. And please remember to count your blessings.